sure that I got everything down, so I'm actually going to be reading the presentation. That's kind of not my normal thing, so I apologize for that. But I am going to go off script just for a second. I think it is huge that we actually have our NCTM president here at TMC. And I've got to shout out Wendy Menard and all of the participants in the Taking a Knee workshop this morning. Oh my gosh, you all rocked it. The level of conversation, honesty, completely blew me away. I'm so, so, so thrilled to join you in this. So let me first begin by thanking Lisa for the introduction, the TMC organizing committee, and our larger MythBox community for this opportunity to address you. I've received lessons from many of you who are here and those of you who could not be. Second, I'd like to acknowledge that the land we are standing on today once belonged to the Potawatomi people who are indigenous to this land. I give honor to them and ask their blessing for our time together today. So I'm not a very familiar name to many, so let me take this opportunity to explain exactly how I got here. I began my 20th year teaching elementary students, and I've always centered mathematics. I was fortunate enough to have a father who passed on his love for the subject to me. Throughout my teaching career, I've centered mathematics in my students' lives. Although I teach all core subjects, I'm most commonly known as their math teacher. Although I didn't have a blog of my own, I followed blogs of math educators learning from them and trying out new things, stealing new things, with my students. Reading Graham Fletcher's blog led me to so many others and led me to the concept of MythBox. Talking to him by phone, he answered my questions ad nauseum and encouraged me to join Twitter and to begin a blog. But I didn't. I felt I had little to say and contribute, and I was quite happy watching from the sidelines. Until November 2016 is when things changed. I joined Twitter seeking answers for why the world was the way it was. I mostly lurked in the beginning, occasionally retweeting, but I really wanted to know how to do school better for kids that look like my own kids. As long as I had been teaching, things really hadn't been getting better for kids of color, and specifically for Black kids. I wanted, I needed answers, and I looked for Twitter for those answers. Yet I didn't see as much as I wanted. I thought it was me. Maybe I didn't know who to follow, or maybe I just wasn't on their radar, because surely those people existed. So when I saw a tweet advertising Twitter Math Camp, it made sense to apply, to seek those answers from the very math community that Graham had introduced me 2 years ago. It was held in Atlanta, so I could attend each day, go home each night. So I got on a wait list, and I was selected, and I was all set. What I found was interesting. I managed to match faces to Twitter profiles, and many gave me friendly hellos. Got a shout out Hedge, where is she? My very first Twitter hug. But I really knew no one. I admit I was surprised that there were not more educators of color, specifically Black educators in this space. I came during a time when people were talking about diversity and the lack thereof, and confronting it. It was obvious this conversation had been going on for a while. I'd come to TMC with a mission to find out everything I could about teaching mathematics in a way that honors students of color, in a way that leads to liberation for us all. I thought surely TMC would have my answer. In short, I came to learn about combining mathematics with social justice. I'm still seeking those answers. From last year until now, I've done things I never thought I'd do. I did start that blog, and I've begun collaborating with virtual strangers. I'm thankful for the examples of Grace Chen and Jose Wilson, to name a few, who've been centering the discussion of equity in mathematics for years. They each delivered a keynote here in the last 2 years, and I am honored to continue the work that they and others have started. Okay, so let's get started. Measures of center, or measures of central tendency, have a particular mathematical interpretation. The analysis of a data set, reducing it into one typical value, is useful to make judgments about that data and how it's used. As an elementary mathematics educator, I'll center the definitions as mean, median, and mode, simply. Of course, data sets are often asymmetrical and contain extreme values, which affects the center. Distributions of this sort can sometimes be described as skewed or even biased. But I am advancing that our mathematical definitions are metaphors for the societal realities. The center is often what or who is valued, since it represents the entire set. Often by framing this measure of center, much of what is truly important disappears. In our discussion today, we'll encounter different frames of center. So this is the first frame, the sports center. From a young age, my husband and I felt it was important to expose our children to sports. Teamwork, discipline, a sense of belonging to something bigger than yourself, a sense of that and physical activity were important to us, and we wanted that for our kids. They tried everything, ballet, gymnastics, soccer, tennis, basketball, softball, and swimming, but finally landing on football and volleyball, playing those throughout high school. Each of them began at age 3, often following each other into said sports. This is my son, he's probably about 8, and his best friend. My daughter at 2, anticipating starting ballet at 3. Both of them in gymnastics because you couldn't do one without the other. Oops. And my daughter in soccer. My daughter began volleyball in 6th grade in Maryland in a recreation league. She decided to get fairly serious about it in 8th grade and talked us into a travel club team. And if you're a parent, you know what that means. Ouch. Your life is now over. So once we moved back to Georgia, she made the freshman team of her high school. So now in volleyball, there are 6 main positions, and she was a pretty good hitter. The hitter is an offensive position. It's front row. It's the last touch of the ball before it goes over the net. So optimally, the hitter should be tall enough to clear the net and hit the ball at that right angle downwards so it's impossible to return. As it turned out, she did have a killer serve and was a pretty powerful hitter by freshman standards. They won their championship pretty easily. In the high school off-season, she wanted to again play for a club team. She set a goal for herself to make the varsity team the following year and knew she would have to raise her competitive level. She worked hard, and she made the varsity as a sophomore, which was pretty unheard of. But eventually, she switched to a defensive specialist or libero because once she realized that her maximum height would be 5'4", she knew she would be able to be a hitter. Here's her varsity team. Now I'm going to ask you to mentally notice and wonder here as I read. Although her high school was diverse, volleyball was not. There were three black girls on the team of 14. The year prior to her coming, there was one. I was the team mom for those 3 years on the team. Do you think that matters? I suppose I did what I'd always done with my children, because they were my center. I sensed that I'd be able to do what's needed to help them navigate the microaggressions they may arise. I received some myself from some of the other stay-at-home moms, so I was able to model some strategies and foresee some challenges. As a libero, a defensive player, she's now a back row player tasked with the last touch. In fact, it was her sole responsibility to dig balls, preventing them from hitting the floor, no matter how hard or how angled those balls were, often sacrificing her body to keep the ball in play and get it to the center. She enjoyed it. It's often called the toughest position, but it's not one that receives glory. She would never be the one to score a kill or make a block, and she would always be the one blamed to hit the floor. This is her club team. Again, mentally, do a notice and wonder. Look at her face. Check the expressions. A little different, isn't it? I believe that she was far closer to these teammates than those on our school team because her racial identity was affirmed. They entered many tournaments in which they were the only black team, and won. They faced microaggressions here, but they faced them together and with their families. The norm for volleyball in our region was white players, white coaches, white families. This team would also have 3 years together, winning tournaments, going to nationals, and playing in the junior Olympics. My son played both as an offensive and a defensive lineman from a young age. You can see here, above this big split screen, here he is at 5, here he is at 16, similar uniforms, similar brown face. Similar to my daughter, he had the first touch of the ball as he began as an offensive center. In fact, his position as center is what gave me the inspiration for this talk. It was his responsibility to snap the ball back to the quarterback, enabling others to make plays. Again, the center, although often also called the most important offensive position, is not one of glory. But he was my center. I would watch him first and the ball second. The same with my daughter. For me, I was in awe of the precision they both had to have to do their jobs as they watched their teammates score. What a responsibility, what a humility. As their mama, I centered them in sports. Yes, I paid attention to the game and to the other players, but if I'm honest, I always had my kids as the center. My focus wasn't on the score, the running backs, or the hitters. I still saw them, but they weren't my focus. Why is that important? If I hadn't centered them, who would? If I didn't look for their moments of greatness, who would? If I wasn't their biggest cheerleader, fan, coach, then who would be? Like his sister, my son made varsity as a sophomore. Their two state championships came before he got there, but they reached the playoffs each year. Many of his teammates went on to Division I scholarships, as did my daughter's club teammates. My daughter decided not to continue volleyball in college, but my son did, and became a college athlete. For us, his choice was a practical one. He still gets to continue a sport he loves, and is in an excellent college that offers what he needs and wants. A small campus, small class sizes, and a coaching staff that recognizes his talent, commitment, and intelligence. I look forward to another season, and I will be there every game, as I always have been. So now a different frame. The Children Center. My husband and I consciously chose to center our children in their blackness. I know what it feels like to be the only one in a classroom, the only one in a group. You're torn because you're proud of your accomplishment, but sad to be treated as the exception. After some years, you find the words to match your feelings, and you're determined that your children will not experience that. You do everything in your power to give them a firm internal center that can be leaned upon when the teacher doubts their ability. We wanted positive black role models for them and sought out a primarily black professional neighborhood in which everyone knew their neighbors. And for 11 years, we had just that. It was often the case that on any given Saturday morning, we would find our son playing next door with his best friend, his 41-year-old best friend named Mr. Gregg, who was like a grandfather to him. Indeed, Mr. Gregg and Miss Jackie served as surrogate grandparents to them, watching each of them during school hours from birth to school age. Weekends and holidays were often spent with them and other neighbors. We celebrated each other's successes. We even vacationed with them. Their preschool and elementary years were spent with primarily black teachers and among black children. My daughter played with black dolls at the mall, the grocery, the pediatrician, and everywhere in our community, they were around black people. This was their center. This was their We never thought about it much, but our children had little in-person involvement with non-black people. But yet they were socialized this way in that world just the same. Every checkout aisle contained magazines with white faces. The television and movies they consumed rarely featured black children as main characters. Our decision was therefore necessary to counter those influences. It was this immersion that set their foundation for years to come and would steel them for the hurdles I had faced, I hoped. This was fine until work relocated us to another state and we were faced with attempting to recreate this normal in our nation's capital. It was a challenge, but we settled upon Maryland suburbia. We ended up in a place that offered the best we could find of both worlds, a track record of demonstrated academic achievement. Yes, it was through test scores, but that's the only proxy I had, among a diversity of students and faculty. My son came to school with me, and we were both in third grade, but in different classes. Watching him navigate among students of different races was hard at times. Finding friends when he was among the few black kids in the high group was difficult. And this gregarious child, who had never had trouble finding friends before, seemed to be floundering. This was his first white teacher as well, my teammate, who never really made a connection with him. The next year, I became the gifted teacher, teaching mathematics to students who qualified for testing. My son had not been recommended for testing by his previous teacher, but the fourth grade teacher did. He qualified, and in fifth grade, he was my student. I wish I could say he loves being in my class. I know, I loved having him. But there was a certain pressure on him to prove that he earned a spot, that he never really got over proving that to his his classmates, their parents, my colleagues. He'd made friends through sports, but not through school. I'd hoped for a better middle school experience. My daughter began middle school on her own and had to prove herself academically as well. Underestimated at first, she was taught by black and white teachers who genuinely loved her. She formed tight friendships that continue today. Yet another job change brought us back to Georgia. But our once ideal neighborhood had drastically changed in the 3 years we were gone, the Great Recession. It proved devastating. We chose a different community similar to the one we left in Maryland. But they discovered that Georgia would not be the same, and their choices were no longer ideal. My daughter continued to excel in high school, but would not have any more black teachers. She kept to herself mostly at school and found her community among her club volleyball team. Microaggressions from teachers, classmates, and school teammates were her new normal. Middle school was tough for my son. The school, highly regarded in academics, was a particularly harsh place for students of color. His seventh grade year was the worst. By second semester, his grades had plummeted, and he seemed to always be in trouble at school. He was on that team, known for harming students of color, especially black males. But being parents, my husband and I didn't know that. Our son tried to handle things himself, as he'd been taught to do. But nothing worked. He finally told us, and he didn't tell us for fear of not being believed. Two team meetings later, we all came to an agreement. The teachers most responsible for his abuse backed off with the damage he had done. So in high school, my son became a social butterfly and fully embraced his underachiever jock role. Although the school was diverse, the football team was overwhelmingly black. He had found social comfort again and was tired of playing the school game. He just did it enough, just enough, to appease his father and I. Both are in college now, out of state, and doing well academically. They survived. But I wonder, what would it have taken so that they had a good experience throughout? I put this slide up because this is how the world looked for my kids. The next frame, the teaching center. Shortly after I joined the world of Twitter, the movie Hidden Figures was released. How many people here have seen the movie? Anxiously awaiting it, I viewed it early in December, right after Christmas. Like so many, I was struck by this important mathematical and cultural history that was new to me. I went to Twitter to read all the tweets about how wonderful the movie was, yet there were few. I told myself that this must be because I had viewed the movie early, before the national release, and I would simply just have to wait. I wanted to process it with a mathematical lens. I told myself that once I waited, surely MythBots would weigh in then. I've alluded to this a few times on Twitter, and I don't mean to reduce anyone's contribution. Please hear me. This is my perception as a person new to MythBots, was specifically looking for something I felt that was missing from my teaching. So the MythBots reaction in my interpretation was indeed a reaction to this hidden history. It was a joyous one. We now had proof of the labor of black women in mathematics and engineering occurring during the civil rights movement, no less. The focus seemed to be on the importance of representation, which I agree is essential. There were field trips to movie theaters, research projects, even living museums. Yet I was looking for something more. What I wanted was for someone to say, "Ah, math is political." But that never came. Let me explain. Hidden Figures is based on the work of Margot Lee Shetterly, who has chronicled a nonfiction account of the stories of black female mathematicians of the Langley Research Center in Virginia, which would later become NASA. They were called computers, who performed calculations largely by hand. There were two groups of computers, of course, since segregation was the law of the land. When the call goes out to recruit a computer specifically for the space task group, an all-white, all-male group, Katherine Goebel Johnson, depicted here as played by Taraji P. Henson, is assigned. So here we have the intersection of mathematics and politics. Computing was then seen as menial work and is therefore relegated to women. And there are separate classes of women, which necessitates their segregation. Many of the characters in the movie are composites of others, but there is a significant attention to authenticity that I find compelling. I found myself asking, how many other Katherine Johnsons are there that I still don't know about? As Johnson and Presser supervisor, despite the daily micro and macro aggressions on the job, composite character Al Harrison gives her an insight into his thinking. He says, "Look beyond the numbers. Look around and through them. Answer questions we don't even know to ask. The math that doesn't exist. Because without it, we're not going anywhere. And then we're staying on the ground. We're not flying into space. We're not circling the Earth, and we're certainly not touching the moon. And in my mind, I'm already there. Are you?" A rich bit of dialogue that begs to be unpacked. Look beyond the numbers, look around and through them, answer questions we don't even know to ask, the math that doesn't exist. Isn't this what we want for our students? To not just regurgitate an algorithm, but to imagine, to innovate? Because without it, we're not going anywhere. An acknowledgement that this innovation is our future. In my mind, I'm already there. Are you? The ultimate challenge is presented. We want our students to see beyond, to visualize in order for this to happen. And yet, there is still another layer here that exists if you choose to decenter the systems. To look beyond is to look past our current oppressive systems in school. To look around and through them to find the math or the ways to rehumanize education that doesn't yet exist. To find a way for students of color to see themselves in our curriculum, to see themselves as capable and innovative. This line really hit me. This is the imagining, isn't it? In my mind, I'm already there. In my mind, my kids and their kids are receiving a humanizing education that liberates and affirms their racial identity in all its ways. So, what's about this oppressive systems that I'm talking about? Reading the book Black Stats this year with the NITBOS book club that Annie Perkins started, we became keenly aware that for many viewpoints, black citizens in this country bear nearly the worst on any measure. Our public schools are mostly black and indigenous people of color, yet it is those students whose scores are lowest, who are retained at higher rates, who are the least likely to be enrolled in gifted or enrichment classes, and are the most likely to be suspended. I know we've all heard reasons for this, but unless you believe that black and indigenous students of color are inherently less gifted, less capable, and more behaviorally challenged than white students, then you must admit that there is something wrong with this picture. Putting it another way, if you are okay with these statistics, then you are accepting this as your normal, your center. No, it's not a matter of poverty and economics. Study after study show that when compared at equivalent levels of family income, the same patterns exist. The same sad statistics are found in health, the environment, sports, entertainment, justice, lifestyle, the military, money, jobs, politics, science, and technology. It is eye-opening. I encourage you to read the text if you haven't already. Last year, Grace gave an excellent keynote about the question of mathematics being political. In analyzing this movie, I find a curious juxtaposition of the themes of patriotism versus oppression. The patriotism is expressed through the seeking of new mathematics, and the patriotism is the backdrop of the oppression of some of those tapped to seek it. The irony is astounding if you allow yourself to decenter the norm to see it. We can't get anywhere with the numbers. To be more clear, they couldn't seem to get anywhere without the numbers of Black women. The scene on the left is when John Glenn and the astronauts are paraded around the NASA employees in a great moment of patriotism. On the right, the very next scene shows Johnson discovering a new coffee pot just for her, reminiscent of separate but equal. Time and time again, we see that Johnson is expected to perform her patriotic duty by doing the math, while that very task is increasingly made difficult, literally hiding some of the information from the calculations she is to check, segregated bathrooms, etc. Did that discussion go into the hidden figure units put forth by the math community? Was this not important to discuss with students? How the racist acts of yesterday were overcome but exist in new forms today? Did you ask any of your students if they could relate? Maybe this does exist in the curriculum, and maybe I just missed those conversations. But this is what I wanted to discuss then and now. I think our students can handle critical analysis. Don't they need to be prepared? Our children deserve the truth, and the truth includes our racist past and present. As Dr. Erica Bullock has written, this lack of discussion amounts to figure hiding. Johnson had to fight to be seen and not hidden. Are you hiding your own students? Or, if you don't teach any students of color, are you assuming their absence in the mathematics? The movie next goes to the story of Dorothy Vaughan, as portrayed by Octavia Spencer. Vaughan sees that human calculators are being phased out and notices the IBM is coming to replace them. Her supervisor, composite character, Mrs. Mitchell replies, "You all should be thankful for the jobs you have." That response seems familiar. Black people hear often that we should be thankful segregation is over and no longer the law of the land. We should be thankful we are in private school. We should be thankful that we weren't in that class. No regard to the system of inequality that exists, or the segregation that still exists, or isolation, dehumanization, or microaggressions that still exist. In the next scene, we see Vaughn and her two sons walking to the library. They pass protest marchers fighting against their segregated city. Once inside, she's approached by the librarian, who quickly asks her to leave because she's in the white section. We should note that she's in the white section to read a book that's not in hers, one of Fortran, which she will need to stay ahead of the computer layoffs. Vaughn refuses at first, but then she's helped out by a police officer, but not before she hides the book under her coat. We then see her reading the book on the back of a segregated bus with her sons, when one son asks if she had stolen it. Her reply is classic resistance. She says that as a taxpayer, she pays for the use of the book. The camera then goes to a picture of a colored versus white fountain. She says, quote, "Separate and equal are two different things. Just because it's the way doesn't make it right." There's so much to teach here. The contrast of citizenship versus inequality. Visualizing mathematics. Predicting patterns in the future of innovation. Strategizing within a mathematics goal. Citizens did not passively accept racism, they fought against it. Resistance in all its forms. Presence of real danger in the work of disruption. Vaughn goes on to teach herself Fortran and the black women she works with, finally earning the supervisor role she's been fighting for. Some quotes that are heard in the background. JFK on the moon. Is racism harder to tackle than traveling to the moon? We have a quote from MLK. I think we as educators need to really ponder this to see if we believe it. Because if not, what are we doing? At this point, we learn the story of Mary Jackson, as played by Janelle Monáe. When asked by her supervisor if she would want to be an engineer if she were a white male, she answers with the famous line, quote, "I wouldn't have to, I'd already be one." She ends up petitioning the court for permission to attend an extension class only offered at a segregated white high school. She does attend the class and continues the road to becoming an engineer. She does so by also demonstrating strategic thinking in her exchange with the judge and resisting the current state of affairs, becoming the first black female engineer at NASA. As Catherine is dependent upon more and more, she's frustrated that her calculations are obsolete soon after she submits them. She requests a seat at the table as changes occur to improve her accuracy. Her demands eventually are met since her work is impeccable. Upon proving her mathematical prowess, she compiles reports of her work only for a man's name to be listed as a solo author. She resists by typing both names, and each time is reprimanded for doing so. Toward the movie's end, she's allowed to list her name along with her supervisors. We can speak to students about authorship and the right to original ideas. Isn't this important in math class? All three women were firsts in mathematics, computer science, and engineering. And they didn't get there by being passive. Each was able to assert themselves to disrupt in ways that they could, although not without consequence. This is the history that must be acknowledged to our students, that even in mathematics, all is not equal. So here's the thing. It's amazing to me that we can look at the same movie and yet see very different things. The reaction and the message I interpreted from MythBoss was this. There are many mathematicians of color we don't yet know about. How can we help students discover them so that they see themselves in the mathematics? My response was that, plus, what would have happened if more black mathematicians were in the space task force? How many brilliant mathematicians were missed? How could we have gotten to the moon faster? Is that possible? do we hide budding mathematicians today? Genius. It's everywhere in the movie. If you decenter yourself, can you see? Why aren't we embracing those that look different than ourselves? Isn't it in our collective best interest? Why can't we see the gift, the necessity of sharing power? If you are standing by while students of color continually lack access to great teaching, then you are modeling compliance for all of your students. Our kids need us to speak up and disrupt, or at least interrogate what's going on. Are you waiting for permission? If you're in a school with no students of color, are you interrogating them? Why do you have none? If you teach with no teachers of color, are you interrogating that? You either believe that our education needs all voices, or you don't. You either believe that if some of those voices were no longer hidden figures, we would all benefit, or you don't. Can we really reach the figurative moon without all of our voices? Or are you teaching your students, your colleagues, your children, that only some of us are smart enough to get there? Representation is important. I was talking to a friend about this talk last week, and I mentioned that I saw a connection between hidden figures and mathematics education. She got quiet. She admitted being emotional as she pondered her school experience and her family history. And she asked me to show you this because it matters. This is her Nana, who was the first Black female math ed student at the University of South Florida. This one's for Val. And now your personal center. I know much of this history is new. It's definitely new to me. It's new because it was hidden. That's what makes the Mythos Book Club so powerful. We chip away at these books one by one so that we can decenter the lies we've been told in our school. We need to improve our racial fluency. We're good with the numbers, not so good with each other, yet. Lean into your discomfort. Ask yourself what you're feeling. Decenter yourself and listen to those who find themselves at the margins. Imagine their point of view. Decentering self is a lifelong journey, but it must be done for our students and for all of us. To revisit the Harrison quote, like Jackson, we've got to look beyond. Like Vaughn, we have to ask the questions we don't even know to ask. Like Johnson, we must invent the math that doesn't exist, because without it, we're not going anywhere. I don't want any more dehumanizing mathematics. I reject teaching this way. I imagine all my students seeing themselves without limit in the mathematics. Because in my